Good morning, y'all. Good morning, Facebook fans. Welcome to our service. We will do the responsive reading. Good morning, Mr. Ludi. How are you doing this morning? And the angel said to them, "Be not afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will come to all the people.
For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord.
And this will be a sign for you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger."
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying,
"Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased."
Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Open our minds and hearts to your word and help us, oh, Heavenly Father, to never forget what this season is all about. This we pray to you in your wonderful, precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
New batteries. Got new batteries here. I'm not Iron Man, but I got new batteries here, too. All right. Okay. That's what I want. That's who I want. Oh! Okay. Hi. How are you? Where's older brother at here? Any more kids? Come on down. I saw a few way up there somewhere. Come on down if you want. I'll just take care of the kids. Hi. How are you guys? Where's Preston? Is he even here? Did you leave him at home? Is he home alone? We'll make a movie about him. Yeah. You don't know where he's at? Really? You don't know? Does mom and dad know where he's at? He was coming down the stairs and he got sidetracked by all the goodies on the coffee table, maybe? No, he's in the Sunday school room. He's somewhere. You just don't know. This is a mystery here. All right. Well, it's just you two and you, I mean, us three. Yeah. Okay. What are we celebrating this Christmas? Who are we celebrating?
Jesus.
We're celebrating
Jesus' birth.
We're celebrating Jesus' birth, right? Okay. And then Jesus was born, right? Do you remember when you were born? I don't either. So, how old is Peter? He's one? Okay. Did you know you're one? Yeah, those are candles. You can't go there. Okay, so, he can't walk yet, can he? So, Jesus was born as a little baby. I believe he was God and he was man when he was born. You're just human. You're just human. Do you think Mary and Joseph walked around with baby Jesus like this? Do you think he did? Do you think they did? Well, why not? Well, would you think that when he was one, that he was walking? What do you think? Guess what? I don't know either. And guess what? All the smart people out here don't know either. I think Joseph carried him around like this. When Joseph went to work in his carpentry shop or whatever he did, I think he carried him like this. What do you think? Do you think they had backpacks in those days where Mary kind of put him in a backpack and carried him around? You don't think so? You don't think so? Oh, I bet you she did. I bet you she carried him around like this a lot. And welcome. Add a little more comments to the theology here. So we're pretending he's Jesus. You're getting heavier, Jesus. And do you think Mary and Joseph carried baby Jesus around like this? No, they don't think so. What do you think? No? What do you think, Lars? Why not? I mean, do you think that Jesus, when he was 6 months old, do you think he was walking yet? I don't think he was. He did walk on water when he was a little older. But I don't think he was walking at 6 months old. Or how old are you? Thank you, you're a year. I knew that. Okay, yeah, just be quiet. Just be quiet, Jesus. Sorry. All right. You just got to think about baby Jesus. We celebrate his birth. He was born as a baby. We celebrate. And you don't think Mary and Joseph carried him around like this? Yes. Oh, we have a taker here. Yes. Do you think Mary kind of taught him to walk a little bit? Don't worry, Mom. I won't do anything. Do you think that Mary and Joseph kind of in the nighttime said, here, Jesus, come on, take your step now. Take your step. Do you think? Well, how did he learn to walk? How did you learn to walk? Do you think your mom and dad kind of, come on, Porter, come on. Come on, you do it. Run to me, Porter. Right? Well, that's how you learned to walk. How come Jesus didn't learn how to walk that? Do you think he just automatically just one day said, hey, Mom, I'm walking? I don't think so. He was raised just like we were. Well, it's about time you showed up. I knew you were around here somewhere. We're just waiting for Preston. We don't know where he's at. Preston, I'm not sending you a Christmas card this year. I don't send anybody Christmas cards for that matter, but especially not him. Who do you think you are? You're coming in late. You didn't have to share that. You're live on Facebook. You didn't have to share, but I appreciate it. I'm Oh, last time I asked kids what they're doing. I'm teasing you. Thanks for being here. So, you don't think that Mary and Joseph kind of taught baby Jesus to walk?
No.
Well, then how did he learn to walk?
He
Would you think he just stood up one day and said, I'm walking? Did you do that? I just, no, leave my glass. Do you think that baby Jesus saw Mary making some cookies and snuck over and when she wasn't looking and do you think she said, get out of there? Do you think that happened?
No.
Do you think he was maybe tempted to steal a cookie off of Mom's baking?
Well,
let me ask you a question, Miss Florence. Let me ask you a question. Stealing is bad, right? I know that. But it's that little cookie right there. Didn't hurt. Just grab the little cookie. No? That's bad, isn't it? Okay, all right. You don't think Jesus was tempted to steal a cookie off of Mom's baking thing? Oh, okay. Just wondered. Jesus is awesome, isn't he? But he grew up just like we grew up, right? You had to learn how to walk somehow. And you don't think Mom and Dad, I mean, stepdad, I got my theology right, stepdad Joseph. I'm going to preach on Joseph today, but you're going to be in Sunday school. But you don't think stepdad Joseph kind of taught him to walk a little bit? I think he did. I think he was such a loving, wonderful stepdad. He just kind of helped Jesus walk a little bit. What an awesome privilege to raise Jesus. Wow. Because that's a great question. That's a wonderful question, Lars. Okay. You going to get your theology right? All right.
Because Jesus was born before they were married.
That's right. The Holy Spirit made Mary pregnant in her womb, and that's a miracle. We don't understand that, but it's a miracle. We believe it. That's what made Jesus unique. Great answer. Okay, you guys are smart. You're wonderful. Just wanted to make you think a little bit about Jesus growing up a little bit. He's a great example of Jesus, isn't he? Right, what do you say, brothers? Do you think he is? Yeah, okay. All right. Well, Preston, since you were kind of the late comer here, would you like to pray? Okay.
Dear God, thank you for all the food and shelter we have, also the water that we can drink. Amen.
Amen. Okay. Before the praise team start, okay. Take him. You guys go. Go back to your parents. Awesome. Okay. Okay, so I want to have a time of special prayer for two people in our church. I know we all need prayer. But before, and I want to pray at least in general for these victims of the massive tornadoes. And I want to encourage you. There's a lot of I call it Christmas giving issues. We even have our own staff Christmas. If you're led to give to that, give to that. But I want to encourage you, especially those of you on Facebook, I want to encourage you to really pray and think about giving online to either Samaritan's Purse, Red Cross, World Vision. I don't know what our denomination is doing right now. They'll have something going to these victims and places, but you know, those are legitimate organizations. Even if you thought of $5 or $10, to just go online and give to those organizations, just a little bit there helps. And that'd be awesome. Maybe our church, out of our benevolent fund, will give something to all of these organizations. Is my understanding they're rushing to Kentucky and Tennessee and other places. They've been hit hard. I'm not promising anything, but maybe we'll connect with the church or something. I don't know, but we're going to lift them in prayer. But I wanted you to be thinking. And I know you're using your Christmas money for a lot of different things, but maybe you can sacrifice and give some money to some of those organizations. They're legit. That they're going to be boots on the ground. They're going to be giving food, water, blankets. Convoy of Hope is another great organization. They'll be bringing trucks into those places. I know that. So any of those organizations, man, you can give to them. I'm just encouraging you to think about doing that. Not in lieu of maybe your faithful tithing here, but just as a sacrifice, as a special cup of cold water. I want to pray for Bill again. Saw him Friday, saw Lieuallen. We want to pray for Bill and Lieuallen. Man, they've been faithful members and leaders of our church and in our church. We just want to pray for them healing. So join with me in prayer right now. And then we'll just enter into a time of worship. It's a real privilege, Lord, this day to be in a collective group and to kind of, using the words of that old hymn, safe and secure from all alarms. I think most of us are pretty safe and secure, and we know where we're going to have lunch, and we know our buildings and our homes are safe right now. We have not been hit by a tornado. We pray for loved ones who have lost loved ones, that there would be supernatural comfort and blessing upon them in their hearts and in their lives. I get it, Lord, that isn't the only tragedy that we can pray for as a church, but that's one that's front and center, and natural disasters are just that. They're not caused by you, but in our world torn by sin, that affects everything, it happened. And you're going to bring good out of things. So thank you for the miracle agencies that are right now with boots on the ground. We pray for churches that are meeting perhaps outside. Churches that are meeting in gymnasiums because they lost their building. We just pray for the body of Christ to rise up in this hour in our country, regardless of political persuasions and all the media junk that we can take in. Just pray that the body of Christ would just rise up and be servants, that we as a congregation in Montana would be servants with our dollars, with our help, with our prayers. Father, we lift up Lieuallen to you today. You just bless her. Create a miracle in her mind and in her spirit, in her body. Just do it, Lord. As she's watching right now, I'm sure, we just lift her to you, that she will feel the impact of our praying together right now. There will be a heat come upon her, and there will be a restoration of something in her life that will be truly miraculous, and it will just be a new perspective. I want to pray for Brother Bill that, Father, as he progresses, as he just continues to receive attention and therapy, that there would be a new miracle in his muscles and nerve endings this season. And I know there are many, Lord, that face their own, just sitting here, or people on Facebook just facing their own crises. I just pray for your presence, Lord. Pray for your presence upon them. And that it would be in double measure upon any illness, any worry, any financial concern, any diagnosis that somebody is weighing on them. Also, I just pray for your grace in people's lives where they feel helpless and they can do things. Just pray for that. So, Father God, as we continue in worship, would you draw near to us? Thank you for giving us a voice to sing and a reason to sing. Not just because it's Christmas, but because it's you. It's you. We thank you, Lord Jesus Christ. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. thank you that you are near, that you are so close. We don't have to look and search to seek you, because you are right beside us. Lord, I thank you that it is the encounter with you that changes us. Not raising our hand, not praying a prayer, not keeping a list of disciplines, but knowing that we are loved by the God of the universe, who not only set the penalty for sin and estrangement, but paid it. Thank you, Jesus, that it is your love that changes us, and that the power of your Spirit leads us and transforms us until the day that we are fully the image of Christ on the earth, where people look at us and go, is that a God? Because that's what they look like. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you do this wondrous work, and for the joy of the Father over us. We just praise you today, Yahweh, in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated, and children can go to Sunday school if there's anyone still left in here.
This needs to be on. Is it on? No? It is there. Thank you. All right. If you have a Bible with you, turn with me to Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. I'm doing a series on miracles. I'm going to use Joseph's story that Matthew records. Matthew chapter 1, 18 through 25. Talk about miracles today. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame and perhaps to death, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered, thought, reflected, probably prayed about this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by a prophet. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel commanded him. He stayed with Mary, one, that was a great choice. He knew her not sexually until Jesus was born, and he called his name Jesus. Three beautiful, simple choices right there that Joseph did. So as I get into this, using Joseph as a backdrop and a context of the miraculous, the title of today's message is going to be As Unexpected As Let me tell you a story. Last month, three pastors went to a church on a Sunday morning. It was dark, and it was dark in the sanctuary. They probably went there to turn the lights on, perhaps turn the heat on, in a town called Sturgis, Michigan. As they approached the church facility, one of the windows, probably a window it looks like on video, about half the size of one of our stained glass windows, but not as high, was broken. And so they thought, as they approached the building, and as they were kind of in the narthex area, as I gather from the story, they heard thumping in the inside of the sanctuary. So they thought there were burglars inside. They went and turned the lights on, and as unexpected as if you followed the news or this news story, as they turned the lights on, they were confronted by a 10-point buck. There is the picture, the only one I could download, of the 10-point buck going up the stairs into the balcony. What the pastors did, they blocked off corridors so the deer could not run into other places of the church building. And it ran up the stairs. And if you want to go on Facebook and just don't right now, not during the sermon, but if you want to go on Facebook, just you'll have to log into their Facebook page if you're on a Facebook, or just go to YouTube. It's on YouTube. Just put Deer in Michigan in the church sanctuary. And you'll see a 34-second video of the deer. He walks around the sanctuary. He goes up into the balcony. He paces back and forth in the balcony. He finally comes back down the stairs and jumps out of the window that he jumped in through. Isn't that something? Now, if I just told you that story, would you believe me without the video evidence? That's a whole nother sermon in and of itself. How do we believe miraculous things? Now here's a truly, I think it's a miracle. I don't think it's a coincidence. I don't think it's a coincidence. It's a funny thing. This was the first day of hunting season in Michigan. That's the truth. That's the truth. And you're going, oh, come on. See, we do that with miracles. Oh, come on. I may address some of that in the message. This was the first Sunday, and so there was actually, and I couldn't download this picture, but it was a picture of one of the pastors who held up a deer crossing sign. They got a lot of laughs out of it. They felt that the deer came in for prayer and got prayer and went away strengthened in the Lord to face the battles. Maybe he dodged bullets miraculously. I don't know. But what a story. As unexpected as walking into the church and being confronted by a 10-point buck. Wow. Wow. That'd be a story to tell your grandkids. As unexpected as an angel in a dream. We're going to use Joseph's plight, his dilemma, as a backdrop of our dilemmas. And I'll get into that in a moment. As unexpected as a miracle, that's but kind of by definition what a miracle is. I realize there are miracles in process. Are we miracles? Yes, we are. You don't have to agree with that, but you are. And you're in process. I'm in process. I'm surrounded by his love, as that song said. So I'm surrounded by his love, and I'm growing. The weaknesses I see in me will be dissipated by the power of his love. That's a miracle in process. But I guess the miracles, that unexpected things that happen, and I'll talk about that later, is what Joseph experienced, because he's going down a path. How do I deal with this dilemma? I'll use him to talk about four things in our life and then how to kind of put yourself in a miracle mindset. That's my sermon this morning. Let me give you a little background just to refresh it, because we're so used to this text. We are so used to this, what Matthew gives us as part of his Christmas narrative. We are so used to it that we forget the details. We forget the culture behind it. Mary and Joseph were betrothed. I can't even say that word good. They were betrothed, betrothal. We don't use that word very much in our culture today. It was a year-long engagement. Their marriages in that day were arranged. There was no dating as we know it. They were arranged. It was arranged by their parents probably to come together. That was no accident. That was no coincidence. God was even in that. He saw Joseph as a godly man. And obviously, Mary was blessed. So they were arranged to get married. In the Jewish culture, this betrothal period was a year long where they would commit, but no sex, no intercourse, and then the groom would go away and prepare a place. So Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. That's part of that Jewish marriage custom. I go to prepare a place for you in a living in a house. And then like the parable of the 10 maidens, the groom would come back and take his bride, and they would have the wedding feast and the feast, and then they would, you know, enter into what we would call the honeymoon period or whatever. It was in this year-long betrothal. We just forget this. We're so used to the Christmas story. We forget this. In this betrothal period, it's when Gabriel came and said, Mary, the Holy Spirit's going to come upon you, and you will conceive in your womb. How can this be? Luke records, I have no husband. We've not gotten together. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and you'll conceive in your womb. You shall call his name Jesus. Okay? Can you imagine the conversation that happened between Mary and Joseph when Mary starts to show? I haven't been with anybody, sweetheart. The Holy Spirit came upon me. And I'm not trying to make light of this. I could say some stupid things here, and I don't want to. This was a very sacred moment. And Joseph is going, yeah, right. Yeah, right. That's his dilemma. That's what Matthew picks up here. Yeah, right. Yeah, the Holy Spirit came upon you. Who were you with? So, that's where we pick up Joseph. He didn't know what to do. He's a godly man. He's a man of faith. Matthew tells us he's a just man. He doesn't want to, John chapter 8, the woman caught in adultery was going to be stoned. I think that Jesus movie, one of them, portrays this, that they were ready to stone Mary, and Joseph protects her. She could have been stoned, but it says in Matthew, he didn't want to bring shame. He just wants to get away from her, get away from this, go back to my carpentry business, I'll find somebody to live the rest of my life with. That's his dilemma. See, we're so used to the Christmas story, we don't understand what he went through. And so we're going to go back before. Yeah, well, Pastor, he has an angel encounter and look at all work. Yeah, I know that. Let's just go back here before we get to the angel, as unexpected as an angel in a dream. All right, we're going to talk about four things about Joseph that hopefully, maybe not specifically, we can relate to his dilemma, but hopefully in general, I'm going to give you four things that Joseph had to experience. And I think you can identify with all four. Hopefully you'll identify with at least one. Situations we can relate to from Joseph's life. Number one, Joseph couldn't control the situation. Joseph could not control how God chose to send forth his son born of a woman. Joseph couldn't control that. Joseph couldn't control the culture that would bring shame on this situation. Joseph couldn't control Mary. Well, that's a good sermon right there. Joseph, men take heart. That was a joke. Some of you are laughing, some of you aren't. I don't know. It's okay. Joseph couldn't control this situation. Anybody here got something in your life you can't control? How about the person sitting next to you? You can't control another person's choices. You might think you influence them. You might think, and you do. I think I'm influencing you, but I can't control you. We can't control the weather. We might think we, I'm not saying we can't pray against it and all that, but listen, we've got situations in our life. We can't even control, I can't even control the remote anymore in our house. So we pride ourselves, even as Americans, even as smart people, we can control things. Wow. Have you got something in your life? I mean, come on. We can't even control my next breath. I'm not even guaranteed tomorrow, the Bible says. We just got to be humbled here. Because if you have something in your life you feel you can't control, you may just be set up for a miracle. That's the good news. So stop feeling sorry for yourself. If you, I can't control that person. I can't control that situation. I can't even control my checkbook. All right. Well, we got things we can't. Joseph could not control this situation. Number two, Joseph needed direction. It says, he was a just man. He was a godly man. He was a man of faith. He believed in Yahweh. He believed in angels. I don't know where he was at with miracles. He was going to find one in a minute when he went to sleep. But he needed direction. I'm sure, you know, it says, as he considered this, that verb consider, there's a lot in that verb. He thought, he reflected, he prayed. What do I do? Anybody here need direction? I'm not saying you need direction of where to shop today, but direction about open doors, closed doors, decisions, issues in your life. What do I say to this person at Christmas time? Direction, anybody here need wisdom? Or are you so smart you've got everything figured out? I don't think so. I think all of us need a miracle called wisdom, direction, insight. I never thought of that before type thing. Number three, Joseph saw only one solution. Did you notice in the text where it says, as he considered this, he didn't want to bring shame on Mary or perhaps protect her from death, so that was a great solution. But he resolved, that verb resolved, I've decided to divorce her quietly. I don't want to bring shame. She's a lovely gal. I don't want to bring shame upon her. I'm not sure I believe her story. I can't believe her story. Let's just be human about this. I can't believe her story. I just want to get away from the situation. He saw only one solution. Get away. Run. Do you blame him? I don't. He just saw one solution. And in his mind, it was a prayer. I prayed about it, Lord. And this is my solution. I'm going to divorce her. Because I prayed about it. And I think he did. All right. He only saw one solution. How do you relate to that one? Hey, just put it in another context of your life. Most of us have blindfolds on. We just do this all the time. I think a real miracle is when you see the big picture of your life and you see the big picture of decision-making processes and you see the big picture of things. But, you know, if you're like me, it's all I see. It's all I see. I don't see those people. It's all I see. That many times is what binds us. Sometimes a real miracle is I see much bigger than just my little focus. I am not using this as an illustration because after our service here, we're going to vote on our budget. Now, I'm just going to use that as an illustration. You'll vote in the affirmative. I'm not trying to prime the pump here. Here's what happens with budgets. It's just a budget. It's a good budget. It's very thoughtful, very faith-oriented. But here's what happens. Happens in my life, we just look at the piece of paper and go, I can't see next July, but God does. That's what we do. I don't blame you if you do that. We only see one solution. We don't see how God's going to supply our needs in July and next September, and how the robbery in 1931 where the stolen money was placed behind a toilet in our church will be recovered next summer. I'm just kidding, folks. Just seeing if you're awake. There was no robbery in 1931 that occurred here. And I've been checking all the loose toilets around here to see if there is. I'm not making fun of that. I actually feel sorry for that situation. Oh. Anyway, that's not going there. I just wanted to share that. Now I got it off my chest. We only see one solution sometimes. How do I know what you're facing in your family crisis? You're just looking at it one way. And a real miracle is you see something much bigger and much more patient. That's a miracle. Now here's the fourth thing, and I've actually just kind of got into the sermon. Haven't you really got to the stuff I really wanted to preach on? Number four, Joseph was not, and I want to repeat, was not expecting a miracle. What he expects is to get away. That was his miracle. He was not expecting, now I lay me down to sleep, I will find an angel tonight type of thing. He wasn't expecting that. I think we read that into the text. He wasn't expecting, as it was unexpected as finding a 10-point buck in the church sanctuary. He wasn't laying his head down at night going, I think I'm going to have a dream and God will give me the full picture. He wasn't. I'm not expecting that. We read that back in there. He had no clue. Though he believed in angels, I think he was raised in a Jewish religious consciousness that believed in angels and believed that God, you know, rescued his people from the Red Sea and from Egypt through the Red Sea. So I think in his background there were miracles, but whether Joseph ever saw personally a miracle, like an angel appearing to him, was probably doubtful. But he wasn't expecting this dream where an angel would give him the backstory. And I think one of the great miracles out of this is that Joseph did as the angel commanded, because Joseph was not a robot. And I realized this was a unique event in history, so I think in my personal theology, though I believe in man's free will, and it's a gift that God has given man, free will to decide, in this unique event, I think God overrode Joseph's free will a little bit. But he did have free choice, I will say that, to maybe not obey as the angel commanded. I think that's a miracle, though, that he did as the angel commanded him. All right. He was not expecting a miracle. Let me just illustrate this very simply. Last Sunday, I was blessed with a unique miracle. None of you saw it, but I'm going to share it with you just, and then I'm going to launch into a miraculous mindset. I recognize people here at church. I really do. I'm not blind, and I saw a young couple sitting in our church, and I saw this young man didn't have much hair on his head, and they were sitting back here somewhere, and I don't know who they were. Great, glad they were visiting. Three lovely kids. She kept one of them in the service. So after the service last Sunday, I just ran over to meet them. As he got closer to me, I'm going, oh my word, I know who you are. And then I confess, I could not remember his first name. And he goes, I'm Lewis. He was our youth director here 15 years ago when he was a student at MSUB. And his lovely young wife was raised in the town where I lived for 13 years. We knew all the right people, though I never knew her. She would have been way, but she would have been a little kid when I was there. And her dad is a retired doctor from there, and he stopped by the church to pick them up. He went to St. Pat's, I think. And he was a doctor there when I was there, but I didn't know him. We knew a lot of people in common. I did not go to bed Saturday night knowing, I expect to see Lewis, our former youth director here. I didn't expect that. That was such a blessing. That was such a blessing to see them and their young family who now live in Portland. Some of you are here, you remember them. But I didn't recognize him. Oh, my word. Has he changed? Anyway, now I remember him. And I remember his name, Lewis. He has his grandparents live in Winifred or somewhere. They were here to see him. That was unexpected. That was an unexpected blessing. I tried to give you these four things about Joseph that you might relate to, that I certainly relate to. Maybe not in the specific things that Joseph had, but just these concepts of sometimes you're not expecting a miracle. You only see one solution. You need direction. Can you relate to any of that? And how do we then apply this stuff? Here's where I want to launch into. What does a miracle mindset feel like, look like? Do we sit around going, I just expect a miracle. It's okay. I pray for them. But it's kind of like two sides of a coin. We're supposed to pray and expect miraculous things. That's what I want you to do. On the other hand, sometimes the most sweetest miracles internally and externally are those things where God just surprises you. Are you in a surprising attitude mode? Or do you just expect the same old, same old? How do we apply this in our situations? Do you even think of God's intervention supernaturally into your life on a daily basis? With that, just like that phone, that must have been a good point because it triggered that phone. Number one, I'm going to give you four or five things here very quickly about kind of, I call it a miracle mindset. It's okay to think that way, to think miraculous things. Number one, realize that God sees your need. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I don't know about you, but when I just realize that God sees my need, it comforts me. Jesus said, your heavenly Father knows what you need before you ask him. There's a place for great prayers and continual persevering prayers. But there's also a place to relax and say, you see my need. And here's the comforting thing. We see the immediate need, right? I need this by the end of the month. God sees our need in August. God sees our need next year. That's so comforting to me. I pray it's comforting to you. That no matter what you miraculously need in your life, God sees deeper than what you immediately need. He sees far deeper than what you're praying for. That's comforting too, that I can rest in the Savior's arms. So realize, I think that's a start of miraculous mindset. God sees your need. Number two, it's okay and it's spiritual to feel helpless. I want to talk about feeling helpless for a moment. Obviously, Joseph was helpless in this situation. God saw his need, and he was helpless in the situation. The only thing he could come up with, obviously, as I've already said, is to get away from the situation. I'm going to talk about feeling helpless for a moment. Because this is two sides of a coin that I want to parse out a little bit. When I say it's okay to feel helpless, what I don't want you to hear is I can't do anything. The feeling of being helpless is not an excuse for laziness or lack of responsibility. Amen? I mean, there are people, oh, I feel so helpless, I can't even get out of bed in the morning and cook for myself. Are you kidding me? Toast works well. I mean, some people use this, and I don't want you to hear that. But there are situations in our life where we just feel helpless, that we cannot change this situation. It's okay. You're being set up for a miracle, I believe. And so I've already talked about that. It's not laziness or lack of responsibility. Feeling helpless is an antidote to trying harder. There's something in me. And I think it's in you. It's a part of our culture that says, I'm just going to try harder. I'm just going to try harder. Sometimes, I don't know about you, but where I feel the power of the Holy Spirit and kind of being set up for a miracle is when I say, I cannot stand this anymore. Oh no, Pastor, you need to buck up and you need to be strong. And I get that. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I've got a strong will. So do you. I've got power in me, but you know what? There's just a place where you say, I'm helpless. You have to do it, God. It's almost like this. If you can understand this analogy, I'm not a snow skier, but I used to water ski once in a while. I had a miracle getting up one time. It's like this. I've got to put myself in the water, and I got to put the skis on. But the only way I'm going to get around the river is by the power of the boat. That's, you're feeling helpless when you're in the water going, I'm ready. Yeah, that's a feeling of helplessness because you don't know where that boat is. And so you just hang on. So it's okay to feel helpless, but there's something I think within all of us that go, no, I can't go there because my masculinity will be ruined or my femininity will be ruined and I'm a strong leader. Sometimes you just have to humble yourself before the Lord and say, I'm helpless. I mean, really? Isn't that going to be the end of our days? One day, all of us will be helpless somewhere, someplace. Right? And the only way you're getting to heaven and the only way I'm getting to heaven is when that angel comes and carries me. Or Jesus himself comes and gets me. That's going to be the most helpless moment, the most salvific theological term, the most salvific moment is when that angel comes and gets me and I'm in my most helpless state. Amen. Amen. So feeling helpless is this antidote to trying harder. Are you in a situation, I'm just trying harder, trying to put my 2 cents in there, trying to make them see my, why don't you just give up and say, I'm helpless. God, if you want to change them, then change them. Because I can't. You can't put a gun to their head and change them. Oh, you might. That might work. I don't know. Might be a little illegal at that point. So, you know, whatever it is in your life, are you afraid to be helpless? I think there was a time, I'm not anymore. I think there was a time in my life, though, I'm going to try harder. All right. Refing took that out of me. And the Holy Spirit took it out of me. And it's still there. I feel that's always in process. Number 3, miracle mindset is to be open to God's intervention and miracles, very simply. If I can do that in these messages, just to be open to God's, do not be afraid of supernatural miracles in your life, in other people's lives. Just to be open. So I'm going to parse this out a little bit, and then I'll finish the final point, and I want to talk about some food miracles. Be open to God's intervention and miracle. Just be open. Now, that sounds simple in a church. In fact, some of you are going, oh, I'm open. Okay? However small the miracle is to you, or small to others, it's huge to you. I just want to make that pastoral point. If you're having trouble, you know, like little Peter, okay, it's going to be a miracle when he starts walking. It's huge to him. It's nothing to me. No, it is to me. I love to walk, man. I think it's a miracle every day that I can do what I do. But you may feel, I just have peace. That's huge to you. Whatever small miracle it is, conversation that you never expected, it's huge to you. When I shared that about seeing Lewis, it didn't mean, probably didn't mean a thing to you. It's huge to me. It's huge to me. That just made my, not that you didn't make my day, but it's people from visit and you haven't seen. So take that to heart. But here's where I want to, perhaps you think I'm not holy enough. Well, I don't pray enough. It's only the holy people that get miracles. Get rid of that thinking. Where does that come from? You are holy in Christ. You are favored in Christ. But you might think, I'm not holy enough to receive whatever kind of miracle or God's intervention you're looking for. You are holy. And none of us are deserving of God's goodness, but he is just so good that don't go there. I'm not holy enough. Don't go there. You are holy in Christ. We're all in process. Amen? Amen. Number two, perhaps you struggle with skepticism. Okay. Are you smarter than the average person? You might be. Maybe you do struggle with skepticism. Maybe if I told you I saw an angel last night, would you believe? I didn't. But would you believe me if I did tell you that? Maybe if I didn't have the video evidence or the picture of that deer, maybe you wouldn't believe a 10-point buck in a church sanctuary. Are you kidding me? Don't we all struggle with skepticism at some level? It's okay. That's not the biggest sin. In fact, I just pray that God overwhelms you with a miracle. You're going to go, I can't believe that this happened in my life. And I repent of my skepticism. Your skepticism is not a problem with God. He had no problem showing Thomas the scars. But don't pride yourself, I'm just skeptical, I'm skeptical. You're not any smarter than anybody else. I don't think. But you may struggle with that. I do too, in some areas. And so, because I struggle with it, I'm not going to get a miracle. That's no problem with God. Number three, here's the biggest one. Perhaps we struggle with being open to God's miracles because I prayed about that and it didn't work in my life. Your negative past experiences speak louder to you than God's word. That's a good point right there, Ross. I'm going to say it again. Your negative past experiences speak louder to you than God's word. And that's the truth. You will always read God's word through your lenses of your experiences. And you just have to put those lenses away and say, I believe it. But maybe I didn't see that person healed, or maybe the money didn't come in, or that forgiveness wasn't there. I hear you. But that's where we're supposed to walk in faith and believe and not just always reflect on those previous experiences. Now, here's the final one I'm going to give you about being open to God's miracles, right? I hope this has been helpful, a little challenging, a little edgy, I hope. Here's one that I think is edgy. Perhaps you really don't believe the Bible. Oh, no, Pastor, I believe in the Bible. I know I've got a few minutes left. I believe in the Bible. I believe in all the miracles of the Bible just because I don't see them today. Some of you may be, and I don't know this, I'm just putting it on the table, some of you may be cessationists. For a long time in my life, I was a cessationist. Where the miracles of the Bible ceased once the Bible became the Bible in 350 AD. By default, I was raised in an atmosphere through certain organizations that taught that, believed that, and there are sincere believers in Jesus Christ who are cessationists. All the gifts are gone, all the miracles are gone, because we now have the Bible. It's called cessationism. I have some good friends, pastors and lay people, that are cessationists by default. But when somebody's suffering from cancer, they'll write that prayer request down. Please pray for their healing. Well, if you're a cessationist, why pray for their healing? They're just going to die. Now, I get it. I'm not trying to answer the problem of healing. What I'm trying to do is say, do you really believe the Bible? That Jesus Christ, Hebrews 13, 7, is the same yesterday, today, and that's it. Forever. Okay? You see where I'm going with, do you really believe in the Bible? Quick joke, and then I'm going to hit the final one and then talk about food miracles, which just, I wanted to encourage you. Young preacher out of seminary, I've told this before, young preacher out of seminary goes to this little country church, and he stands up and he preaches on Jonah. It was a good sermon, except he said, I don't believe that Jonah, it's just a myth and a fable that Jonah spent 3 days in the belly of the whale. Okay, it was a good sermon, but he said, I just don't believe in that miracle. This little old lady came up to him and said, son, it was a great sermon. It was a great sermon. I'm really glad you're here. But I take offense, and I want to correct you that Jonah did spend 3 days in the belly of the whale. The young preacher said, no, he didn't. Yes, he did. He spent 3 days. It was a miracle. He spent 3 days in the belly of the whale. No, he didn't. Yes, he did. No, he didn't. Yes, he did. And finally, the young preacher wasn't getting anywhere, and neither was the little old lady. So she said, I guess when I get up to heaven, I'm going to ask Jonah, did he spend 3 days in the belly of the whale? To which the young minister didn't want to be outdone, and he said, what if you get up to heaven and you find that Jonah isn't there, but he's in the other place? The little old lady said, well then, young man, you can ask him. That's a good one. I do sense, though, in all seriousness, in all of our lives, because we're modern people, right? You go to Africa, you go to India, man, you'll see miracles. You will. There is this gap in our culture between the miracles of the Bible and my everyday miracles. There's a gap. And it causes us to doubt. Causes us to doubt. Number four, with this, never dismiss inner miracles. Even though what I'm going to read to you, and I am going to read, just be patient, you'll love these stories. Never dismiss inner miracles. I can experience God's miraculous presence with a new perspective. I just have a new perspective. That's huge. Joy, love, peace, assurance. I pray that you walk away today just feeling God's assurance and peace and joy and love on your life more than you ever have. That's wonderful. Never dismiss those inner, emotional, spiritual things. I don't have to see an angel. If I did, that'd be cool, but I'd be held to a greater responsibility, I think, that maybe I don't want. But just to experience his love and joy, peace, assurance of salvation, forgiveness, my sins are washed away. That's miraculous. Never dismiss those every day. I see this person in a different light. That's miraculous. So never dismiss those inner miracles that you're going to experience. Just because somebody says they were healed or they received $10,000 in a windfall thing or whatever, or whatever. I just use little Peter as a, just learning to walk in faith is a miracle. Having said that, I want to finish the sermon. I'm going to promote his book I'm reading, J.P. Moreland, Experiencing Miracles, Zondervan 2021. It's right here. I'd encourage you to order it off of Amazon. He, in my opinion, professor of philosophy, two PhDs. He's probably mentored more philosophy professors in Ivy League schools than any one person, but he's professor of philosophy at Talbot Seminary, California, and college, Biola University. Smart, one smart cookie. Very humble man. I've met him personally. He's on YouTube. You can Google him on YouTube. It's a great book. Very thoughtful book. I think he's a modern-day C.S. Lewis, Experiencing Miracles, J.P. Moreland. He's documented these miracles, and I'm going to, these are food miracles. I thought this was interesting. I had envisioned myself sharing from this book today in light of the other natural disaster that our country is going through. But this is one, a previous one. I'm going to read just spots of it here. These are awesome miracles. They're food miracles. From a church in Port Neches, Texas. Did I get that right? On the weekend of November 9th, I spoke at an apologetics conference in Port Neches, Texas, hosted by Dr. Jason Martin, the new pastor at First Baptist Church in that town. It's a town of about 13,000 people, and the last week of August, a Category 4 hurricane named Harvey hit that town and decimated the town. I won't go into everything. $1.3 billion worth of damage occurred at Port Neches alone. So this church now is going to take it upon himself to feed hungry people. Workers, evacuees, they must have a pretty good-sized kitchen like ours. We needed to feed people. I opened the refrigerators and freezers, and they were mostly empty. We had about 3 dozen frozen biscuits and some miscellaneous items, along with 2 gallons of milk. They were hosting about 500 people in their gymnasium. We cooked whatever we had, knowing that there was no way this was going to feed all these hungry people. But we did what we could. We set out the food, and somehow we ended up with leftovers. Even though there was clearly not enough when we started cooking. The babies were fed first, then the mothers, and then the men. Everyone who wanted to eat did so. Well, they wanted to set up, there was a volunteer group that arrived. They wanted to set up showers for them to run on generators, but they realized they did set up some showers. They got some shower trailers to come to their parking lot so they could the workers could have showers. That makes sense. They needed generators. They got generators. What does it take to run generators? Diesel. They had no diesel. So a group of us prayed in the parking lot that God would supply diesel fuel. Just as we were finishing our prayer, as we stood in a circle in our church parking lot, a man pulled into the lot. He had a trailer full of 5-gallon containers of diesel, and he rolled down his window and asked, "Does anyone need diesel?" We looked at each other in shock. Here he was, offering us the diesel fuel we needed within 60 seconds of our having finished our prayer. It was a clear miracle. This is the one I really like. Lynn Jackson is the head cook at this church. You do not argue with the head cook, right? Amen. Yeah, I heard some men go, yeah. We had to feed around 500 people. I was encouraging our staff to go home and sleep. We were working around the clock for multiple days. Folks were exhausted. Lynn Jackson was preparing the meals. Lynn had been constantly feeding folks, and people had just kept on bringing in food. It was wonderful. But she just received another request to feed 500 people in a neighboring town. I went outside to look at all the trash that was piling up, and Jeanette came out to tell me we didn't have enough food to feed those 500 people. "We're running out of food," she said to me. So I told her, "Let's pray. Lord, you know the need. Amen." That's all they prayed. Just as we were finishing that prayer, the door opened and Lynn, the head cook, walked out. And she goes, "I know my kitchen. And I know what is here. A few minutes ago, we had no food for this group of 500. Now our freezer is full of chicken tenders, more than enough to feed them." We just looked at each other and smiled. I was going to call this sermon Chicken Tenders. One more. We had the food. We had the food to feed about 1,000 people in another town during this crisis, but we didn't have any food containers. Jeanette and I were talking about some logistics when Lynn came up, the head cook, and said, "Food I got. What I don't have are containers." Before we can even pray, an 18-wheeler pulled up and the driver said, "I have an 18-wheeler full of food containers. Do you guys have a need for them?" We still have a few of those containers today. All right. I just want to encourage you with those miracles. Now, if you're here and you're kind of skeptical, I just want to challenge you. I want you to call Port Neches Church in Port Neches, Texas, and I want you to talk to their head cook, Lynn. You can trust her. That's some good stuff. That's some good stuff. What's the good stuff in your life that you need to say, "Okay, God, I'm open"? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, the things that I've shared are but 5 loaves and 2 fish, if even that. Just multiply it into our lives. The miracles that I read, Lord, are nothing to you. You're just smiling. You're just smiling on us and going, "Yeah, no problem." And I think you want to say that to every person, either online or in person, just going, "No problem." I'm not afraid of our hopes being raised too high. I'm afraid of our hopes not being raised high enough. Because some of us live in a grave. Some of us live, Lord, in a sense of, "Well, I haven't had anything happen." And just even just peace would be awesome. So I just pray, Lord, you know we're open. And how do we know that miracles haven't happened even though we didn't see them? Maybe that car that was destined to run into us was diverted, and we never saw that. Lord, we just thank you that you care for us, love us, heal us, touch us, and bless us, not so that we would be a witness and a testimony. And be it unknown to anybody else, I pray that whatever we give this Christmas season would be miraculous. If we do the online to these organizations, or we just give something special, may there be miracles multiplied in some of these places, Lord, that have been devastated this weekend. We pray that. I pray your blessing. We look to you, Lord, because we worship you and adore you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing. Let's stand and sing as we finish. Remember our meeting 2 minutes after our final. Oh,